Good afternoon, Doctor. If you can come up to the witness stand to my immediate right. Doctor, before you are seated, let's get you sworn in. If you would raise your right hand, state your name and spell your last for the record.
Roger Salem.
Spell your last name.
S-A-L-E-M.
Do you swear or affirm under the penalty provided by law that the testimony you're about to give this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you, Doctor. Please take your seat. So, Hutchison, when you're ready.
Thank you, Doctor. Good afternoon, Doctor. Doctor, could I just have you reintroduce yourself again to the jury, please? Just reintroduce yourself, your name again.
Roger Salem.
Thank you. And by whom are you currently employed?
Capital Health.
And how long have you been with Capital Health?
Since 2001.
And where's Capital Health located at?
There's two hospitals, but the one I work mainly at is Capital Health Regional Medical Center, which is on 750 Brunswick Avenue in Trenton.
And was it previously called something else?
Gleanfold. Yes.
Now, prior to working in Trenton, do you have any other hospital experience? Any other working in any other hospitals?
I was a trauma surgeon from 94 to 2001 at Cooper in Camden, Cooper University Hospital in Camden. And I worked for a year at Atlantic City Medical Center as well.
Now, where did you complete your undergraduate degree at?
City College in New York.
And how about medical school?
Mount Sinai, New York as well.
Now, any training, residencies you have you after medical school?
Yes, I trained in surgery. I was at Brooklyn Hospital. I was also at Montefiore University, and I finished my training at Detroit, Point State, in Detroit.
Thank you. Now,
I did a one-year fellowship at Cooper Hospital in Toronto.
Now, what is your specific title from the hospital currently?
Trauma surgeon.
And was that the same title or position back in October of 2018?
Yes.
Can you just explain briefly to the jury, what are some of the responsibilities that a trauma surgeon has?
Well, we simply say we take care of anyone who comes in severely injured. So they come in and we're there to take care of them when they arrive.
Can you relay to the jury some of the types of injuries that you've treated in the past, severe injuries?
Essentially, gunshot wounds, stab wounds, motor vehicle crashes, falls, those are the main ones.
Now, approximately over the course of your career, how many surgeries would you say you performed?
5,000.
Okay. Now, I'm going to direct your attention specifically to October 12th of 2018. Were you working that day?
Yes.
And do you recall what your shift was?
I was on call. I was on duty for the trauma center. Each one of us takes turns being on call to take patients, new patients that come in.
Now, did you at some point treat an individual who arrived via ambulance suffering from multiple stab wounds?
Yes.
And do you recall the name of that individual?
When he came in, he wasn't named. We assigned numbers until we ID'd them, but his name was Paul Stevens. Okay.
And do you recall where he was first taken upon exiting the ambulance?
Right off the ambulance, we bring him into what's called a trauma bay, where we take all the injured patients first to take care of them, work them out, do any immediate treatment that needs to be done. That's where he was taken.
Now after the trauma bay, do you recall where he went next?
After the trauma bay, he went right up to surgery, to the operating room.
Now, is that common for people to go right from a trauma bay to the OR?
If they need to, they go. But most of our patients come in aren't that sick. They wind up getting x-rays or getting other treatment. They don't usually go straight to the operating room.
Now, can you describe the state or condition that Paul Stevens was in at the time he came into the hospital?
So he came in, he was in shock. He was very sick.
Can you explain to the jury what do you mean? When you say shock, what do you mean by shock?
Well, in his case, he had lost a lot of blood. And again, when he came in, we knew from the report, seeing him, that he was stabbed multiple times. So we immediately knew that he had likely that he lost a lot of blood. And initially, his blood pressure was low and his heart rate was high, so we knew he was in what's called hemorrhagic shock, or lost a lot of blood, so he was pretty sick, with blood loss.
If you approximately how much blood would you say he had lost upon arrival?
Well, in a healthy individual, to get to that state, you have to lose about 40 or 50% of your blood volume before you get that state.
Would you say, is it fair to say that without surgery, there was potential that he may have bled out?
Objection.
So yes, he most likely would have died if we had not operated on him pretty quickly.
Did he receive any blood transfusions that day?
Yes, he did. He received. Actually, we started giving him blood even before we took him up to the operating room because we knew he had lost a lot of blood. Then he got. He received more blood afterwards.
Now, throughout his stay in the hospital, did you issue reports?
Well, when these patients come in, we write up a history and physical, and I actually also dictate a history and physical. I also dictate any of the surgeries that I do. So, yes, we do reports.
And at some point, did you refer to his assessment as, quote, extremist?
Yes.
And what does that mean?
Just that he's very sick, much sicker than our average patient that comes in, meaning that if he doesn't get immediate attention, he may die.
Now, how many stab wounds did you yourself observe?
So he had, I counted five on him, four that were clear stab wounds and one that was kind of more of a superficial, like an abrasion, but we still counted it because it looked like it was a laceration there as well.
Now, do you recall where these stab wounds were?
I recall, I would have to refer to the judge again specifically where they were. I do recall approximately, but if you
if you looked at your reports in this case, would it help you refresh your recollection?
Yes, we report exactly where our patients are stabbed.
All right, I'm
going
to show it to you what's been pre-marked as 36A.
Thank you.
Now, just for the record, how can you tell that that's related to this case specifically, the document that I just handed you?
Oh, he has a sticker on there that identifies. It says, here it's listed as a trauma number, but that's how he was identified when he came in.
Okay, thank you. Now, can you speak to the stab wounds?
So he, on every routine that we do, is we have a little diagram, and we actually mark where patients are either stabbed or shot, so we have exact location. So he was stabbed once, right upper chest. Right, like in the middle, right below his ribs, and then he had two stab wounds lower than that. One was on the left side of his abdomen, and one was on the right side as well. And then he had a kind of what's listed here as an abrasion or a small superficial one on the right flank on the side.
Now the document that you're looking at does it have a very small body diagram on it?
Yes.
I'm going to show you what's marked as S37. Larger version. Doctor, if I were to ask you if you would be able to mark on here, on this diagram where the stab wounds were, would you be able to do so? Now, with regard to any of these wounds, were you able to tell kind of the direction of the stab wound?
No, we could tell they're, just looking at them, we could tell they look like they were deep, but you can't really tell the direction. I mean, if you probe them, you do, but we don't know how to do that. So.
The stab wound that was in the chest, in the upper middle chest, was it close to the heart?
The one in the middle there, yeah, very close.
Did you have any concern whether or not it had struck the heart?
Well, that's, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that one, again, it all depends on the direction the knife goes. If it goes up, it gets his heart. If it goes down, it goes down, it gets his intestines or stomach.
Okay, and in this case, what was nicked, in, or what was...
So that one actually, he was lucky, he went downward and he got his stomach.
Okay. Now, on October 12th, on that day in question, did Paul Stevens undergo surgeries?
Yes.
And can you tell us what types of surgeries he had to undergo that day?
So he went up to the, after he came in, we took him straight to the operating room. He had, he had what's called a pericardial window, where we make an incision or make a cut up near his heart and basically just kind of check to see if there's any blood around his heart. We open it up, there's a sac around there called the pericardium. We open that up and we just look for blood, and which he did not have, so that indicated to us that the guy food did not hit his heart. And then the next thing we did is we did what's called an exploratory laparotomy. We just make a cut down the middle from the top down to above, to down toward his pelvis. And he had injuries there where he had this stab wound had hit his stomach, that one up there, had also injured his cecum and his small intestine. And one of the stab wounds had gone down and hit one of his arteries, his internal iliac artery.
And which stab wound would that have been?
So the one on the right side.
On the lower right quadrant?
Lower right one, yeah. That went down and got his artery.
Now, all of the surgeries that you just mentioned during that time on October 12th, were they all done while the victim was under the same anesthesia?
Yes.
Meaning all doctors kind of working on him at one time?
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
What was done to Mr. Stevens next in the way of treatment?
After the surgery?
After the surgeries on October
12th. So at surgery, he had... Again, we repaired his injuries, his stomach, his intestine. His artery was actually what's called ligated. It was tied off to stop the bleeding. By now he had, there's enough swelling that goes on that you can't close people directly because there's too much pressure. So he was left what's called, we did a temporary abdominal closure. He had, so we just basically, leave a plastic sheet to close him with, so it's not open, but it's not closed primarily. So he was taken from there to the intensive care unit where we just continued to treat him. Don't recall, probably gave him more blood and fluid.
And
he was on a ventilator at the time.
Thank you. Do you recall how long Paul Stevens was on a ventilator?
I'd have to refer to the chart, but he was probably 2 to 3 weeks total.
And how long can a person generally stay on a ventilator?
Well, they stay on as long as you need. I mean, he stayed on 2 to 3 weeks because he was sick enough that he couldn't breathe well enough on his own to be off the ventilator before that. But we have patients sometimes stay months on the ventilator if they need it.
Now, following his initial treatment on the 12th, you stated that he was left open per se and not completely closed during that surgery, meaning his abdominal. Was there a follow-up surgery with regard to that?
Yeah, he had a few days later, he went back, I think on the 15th, had a more surgery done. At that time, we tried to close him, but he still had too much swelling. So then he went back again on the 19th, and that time we were able to finally close him.
Did he have any surgeries after the 19th when you closed the abdomen?
Oh, he also had a tracheostomy done to help get him off the ventilator.
And do you recall when that was done?
Just referring to the records. Yep. So on 26th, he had a tracheostomy done.
Okay. And why was that done again?
Well, to help him with his get off the ventilator, essentially. So he was still on the ventilator at that time.
Stevens came in on the 12th, did he have any other injuries or any injuries that maybe would have been consistent with a physical altercation of any type?
Not that I recall, and not that's written in his record, no.
Okay, so there's nothing documented in the reports?
No.
And nothing that you specifically recall?
No.
Now, based on your training experience, would you say that vomiting or urinating on yourself or defecating on oneself is consistent with these types of injuries that he had?
Yeah, that's when you start losing control of your bladder and bowels, it's usually when you're very sick. Yes.
Now, were you the primary surgeon overseeing Paul Stevens during the entirety of his stay at the hospital?
Yes.
There is a team of surgeons at the hospital, is that
correct? Well, the six of us, we do share the responsibilities with all the patients. But he, since I took care of him when he first came in, I kind of more or less took care of him, oversaw his case more than the others. But we do share the work, though.
Do you recall how long Paul Stevens' stay in the hospital was when he was discharged?
Approximately a month.
Would it help your recollection with the date specifically if I were to show you documents as to the discharge instructions?
Yeah.
He was admitted on October 12th, before he was discharged?
Mm-hmm.
Now, why so long? Why was he there over a month?
Well, he was very sick, so it just needed him that long to get better.
Now, at some point after he left the ICU, did he have to go through and receive types of physical therapy and occupational therapy as well?
Oh, yeah. He was in the intensive care unit for an extended period of time, so the routine thing to do after they get better, he needs basically therapy to get up walking, those kind of things. Strength back.
Now, you and I had the opportunity to meet prior to you coming and testifying today, is that correct?
Yes.
And we went over the medical records kind of in their entirety, is that right?
Yes.
And do you recall how many medical records were generated for Paul Stevens for this stay at the Trenton Hospital? Okay. I'm going to show you what's been marked as S36. Not counting A and B. Does that look about right, what we went through that day?
Yeah, yes.
When Paul Stevens came in on October 12th, how would you categorize his injuries?
Life-threatening. Immediately life-threatening.
No further questions.
Mr. Masciocchi, your witness.
Thank you, Your Honor. Dr. Wynn, you were one of the first doctors to examine Mr. Stevens when he came in to the emergency room on October 12th.
Yes.
And you indicated a few minutes ago when you testified that the only wounds you noticed on, at least notated, in the record were the stab wounds you identified earlier.
Yes.
And there were five, was that four and one laceration for a total of five?
Yes.
Did you notice whether or not there were any defensive wounds of any nature on Mr. Stevens?
No.
The individual stab wounds, did you examine, I'm assuming you examined each one of those, correct?
Yes.
And could you tell whether they were, the type of thrust it was that created each of the wounds? And by thrust, I mean in and out versus up and down.
No, couldn't tell.
You were aware, too, that he was stabbed by a knife, correct?
I presume that by the way they were. I don't recall they ever actually told me what he was stabbed with. But
could you tell them looking at them whether or not they were stabbed?
They're appear to be knife wounds, yes.
And could you tell them looking at the wounds, well, let me strike that, did you examine the depth of each of them?
at the time when he was first brought in, no, we didn't. At the time of surgery, we got a sense of which direction and how deep they were at the time in the operating room.
And looking at those wounds, could you assess how far away from Mr. Stevens' assailant was?
I couldn't tell that. I could guess how deep the wounds were because you could see how far the injuries were in his body, but I couldn't. That's about all I could tell.
You couldn't tell from looking at the wounds as to whether or not they were thrust, like a parry sort of thrust into the...
No, again, I could tell how deep they went, because you can see how far the injuries were. But that's all I'm going to tell us how deep they and the direction they went.
Now, with regard to his care, is he a cooperative patient as far as patient care?
Oh, yes. I don't recall us ever having any issues with him. And I don't believe anything's recorded that he was ever a problem.
I don't know the questions of the doctor.
Does the state have any further questions?
One second, Mayor, please.
Sure. Dr. Salem, I appreciate the time today. Your excuse. Thank you.
Well, just back.
Just leave those right there. We'll take care of those. All right. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going as far as we're going to go for today. We'll resume tomorrow. I'll give you your instructions for the evening. Your report times tomorrow is 9:30. And we'll go forward from there, but we're done for today. You are not to discuss this case with anyone, not the other jurors, not a spouse or a close friend until this trial is over. You're charged by me on the law and instructed to begin deliberations. Then you may discuss the case only with each other and only when all 12 of you are in the jury deliberation room. Do not read or listen to any television, newspaper, or other account of the trial or case. Do not conduct any internet or any other personal research or investigation. You may not communicate with anyone about this case on your cell phone or through any other electronic means. You are only to consider the evidence seen and heard in this courtroom, and you may only discuss the evidence during your deliberations. Do I have your collective assurances?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for today's service. 9:30 tomorrow. I'll